here in Dallas. Eddie Barker, the news director of KRLD, bringing you up to date. The reason that the mobile unit was set up at the trademark that at 1 o'clock today, President Kennedy was scheduled to make a speech. Now, on my right and on your left is a crude, and you'll excuse the artwork, with apologies to you, Sam, of where in Dallas the shooting took place today. Dallas is off to your left. This is Main Street. This is the county courthouse and the jailhouse in this block here. This is the triple underpass that we have referred to. This is where President Kennedy, Johnson, and as I understand it now, a Secret Service man was shot at about, Conley was shot at approximately 12:35 today. And from our eyewitness that you saw earlier, was shot from up in here. This is an overpass going over these streets. We call it our triple underpass because there's another one, was shot from here. Conley arrived last night in Fort Worth to a warm reception. It was raining up until about in Dallas and in Fort Worth up until about, 9:30 or 10 o'clock this morning. And everybody was saying, well, the president brought the rain with him, because those of you who have been in this area recently know how bad we have needed the rain. He made a speech this morning at 9 o'clock that was carried on television about, I beg your pardon? Let's go back to the network now and see what they have.
The operating room, that the vice president is fine. She was taken back into another first floor room where Johnson originally had gone. Asked if her husband also had been wounded, she shook her head negatively. She said he had not been. Secret Service man pushed reporters away and permitted no more questions. Of course, you can imagine the confusion, the emergency circumstances, the confusion that must exist around that hospital. Now we understand that we are ready to switch to Washington for a report from there. We are ready to go to Washington. Come in, Washington. We are ready to switch to Washington for a direct report from there, but for some reason, under the circumstances, we seem to be having a little difficulty with that, which I'm sure will be cleared up in a moment. Come in, Washington. We were told from our control room here in New York that Washington was standing by with a report, but we've been unable to reach them at this moment. I'm sure that in a matter of seconds, perhaps in another minute or two, we will be able to reach Washington. Did you have something else, Ed Silverman?
I just thought we might recap for those who probably heard about it just a few moments ago.
I think that's a good idea.
What happened, that the president and Governor Connally were shot on their motorcade as it entered an underpass while going through downtown Dallas, and when the shots were first fired, there were thought to be three. That later was confirmed there were four shots. The president fell over face down. Governor Connally apparently was wounded in the body. He fell forward. Mrs. Kennedy leaped up and cried, oh no, and tried to hold the president's head up. Blood was seen on the president's head, and a Secret Service agent apparently was shot by one of the assassin's bullets as well. And, of course, you have it from there on.
Thanks very much, Ed. In case you did join us late or had not heard the news, those are the facts, so far as we know them up to this time. And last... I'm receiving word now. We have received word that two priests who were with the president have reported that the president is dead. Now, here again, we must emphasize that this is not an official announcement. It has not been announced by the White House or anyone in the official party traveling with the president. But the Associated Press quotes two priests who were with the president stating that he died from the bullet wounds or wound inflicted upon him by a sniper. We have to assume that it was a sniper who fired from a considerable distance. The president was given the last rites of the Roman Catholic Church at about 1 o'clock Dallas time. And at that time, the first reports were that the president was still alive. However, this latest word says that the priests were under the impression the president was dead at the time the last rites were administered. Now, we, of course, are going to keep the air here, and we will bring you whatever reports come in as they come in from the wire services, from our reporters on the scene, and from Washington and Dallas directly. We will be going to Washington before long for a direct report from there. Ed Silverman is sitting here beside me. He has a telephone to Dallas and is in touch with our reporter, Bill Lord, who is at the hospital and has been in touch with people at the scene. Ed, is there anything new there?
No, there is nothing new, Ron. Bill left the phone to check with the sheriff's office. He did confirm the death of the Secret Service agent, the fact that at least a dozen eyewitnesses have been brought in for interrogation, and the fact that one suspect has been picked up. He is in there being questioned now. There have been no details. Everyone is being very close-mouthed in the sheriff's office. And, of course, there is a great deal of rumor, Bill mentioned, a great deal of rumor, as is understandable at a time like this. So we would hesitate to pass any of that along. We'd stick strictly with the facts as we get them.
Thank you, Ed Silverman. Now we're going to try again to switch to Washington and Edward P. Morgan. You are seeing Edward P. Morgan, but at the moment, unfortunately, you are not hearing him. We'll get that problem straightened out shortly. We have a report that Senator Edward Kennedy, the president's brother, was presiding over the Senate today when word came that the president had been shot. An aide informed him, and he rushed out of the Senate chamber. Attorney General Robert Kennedy, the president's younger brother and closest advisor, was having lunch at home when the word came of the shooting. The president's personal secretary said the attorney general was remaining at the Kennedy Hickory Hill estate in McLean, Virginia, awaiting further word. Newsmen carried the word to House Speaker John McCormick at a luncheon table in Washington. He said, "This is terrible. All I can say is that it is a terrible thing, and all Americans of all religions and faiths are praying for the president and Governor Connally." Now,
I was thinking that of all the people.
Now, now we're receiving a report here. The United Press reports. The United Press reports that the president died at 1:35. That would be 1:35 Eastern Time, I presume. That would have been about 1:35 Central Time. That was only about 2 minutes ago. Now, that, again, is a United Press International report. It is not attributed. We do not know whether that is an official announcement by anyone in the Kennedy Party. We have another photograph of Mr. Kennedy in the motorcade, which was taken minutes before the assassination attempt. This is a still photograph of the president in the motorcade. You see he's riding in an open car, and we're informed that the time that the shot struck him, he was standing in that car, unfortunately, apparently making a good target for the sniper, who was hiding somewhere and may have fired from a considerable distance, probably with a high-powered rifle, considering the accuracy with which he shot. And also the fact that one of the Secret Service agents was killed. The Secret Service agents normally walk directly beside the car on either side. We do not see any in this photograph, but usually two or three Secret Service agents will walk on either side of the car so that they are there to spot anyone who looks like a troublemaker. Government sources now confirm. We have this from Washington. Government sources now confirm that President Kennedy is dead. So that apparently is the final word, and an incredible event that I am sure no one except the assassin himself could have possibly imagined would occur.
It is 1:35 p.m. It has been officially confirmed President Kennedy is dead. In Dallas, it's been reported that police are looking for a suspect in Oak Cliff. Channel 8 program director Jay Watson and assistant news director Bert Shipp are on the air.
The gentleman sitting on your right, my left, is Bert Shipp. We'll have some film to run in just a few moments, but right now what we're going to run is a videotape recording of the program we had on the air here at about 1:45 today, immediately about 10 minutes after President, 12:45, I'm sorry, Central Standard Time, 12:45. We'll roll that tape. Bert is assistant news director and chief cameraman and so forth. Bert, a black day.
Indeed it is, Jay, but from the last report from police, they are converging on an area in the 300 block or somewhere near the 300.
Let's not give it with maybe too many people.
Oh, well, they're already out there. But anyhow, in Oak Cliff, and they believe that they might have the assassin out there. They're looking for a white male, 35, about 5'8 in height. He got a white shirt, and that's about all I know right now. But they are putting an unusually great number of policemen out in that area. And so that's why we take some strength into this, in this just routine call. And also, there's been a report that a policeman's been shot out there. Well, he's shot and killed, I don't know.
Well, is it confirmed now that the Secret Service man and, we don't know the condition of Connolly now, do we?
No, we don't. He was sent.
He is all right. Good.
And, of course, he was shot in the chest. And the first details from the Parkland Hospital, very sketchy. Mm-hmm. It just, we talked to Congressman Wright. We talked to Senator Ralph Yarborough. And they were, so as you'll see on the film in a moment, are very visibly shaken.
Bobby, let's hold the film, please. Of course, the film that Bert is talking about is unedited and it was rushed through, and we'll have more film throughout the day as the boys bring it in. We are not making any attempt to edit it down, as you would see on our regularly scheduled newscast, because it's impossible, and you understand that, I am sure. The time now is 20 minutes until 2 o'clock Central Standard Time. The president died 5 minutes ago. He arrived in Fort Worth last night. This morning at 9 o'clock in Fort Worth, he made his speech. At 10, at 11:35, he arrived in Dallas. And at 1, at 12:35, is that right? At 12:35, he was shot, and an hour later was pronounced dead. He died in a hospital after being cut down, as you know now. The call went out about 30 minutes after we arrived back in the station, which would make it about 5 minutes after 1. Call went out for the top specialist in the Dallas area, also for two priests who were there. The eyewitness report that we're going to play back here in just a moment that we aired earlier this afternoon, the eyewitness said that they could see the bullet hit Mr. Kennedy, and also see Governor Connolly double over. Bert was telling me out at the trademark, you knew something was wrong the minute the car came by at 70 or 80 miles an hour.
It was going full speed, and we thought that they were just going to slow down, but they didn't. They went right on past it, and for about had to go about a mile from the trademark to the Parkland Hospital, and they were going in top speed, and we hadn't even a chance to get any pictures. Mm. We were a good distance away, but we hopped in a police car and went on out to Parkland, where we got these.
Bert, why don't you scoot up for just a minute and let Pierce Allman come in. Pierce is a program director of WFAA Radio. Pierce, how are you?
I'm a little bit shook right now, Jay. I didn't know until I got back and went into the newsroom just now that the president had died. Mm-hmm. Because where I was locked in the Texas School Book Depository building. I headed for there right after the shots. And they weren't letting anyone.
Pierce, excuse me here. We have our tape ready to roll.
You're on the air. You're on network feed.
We are feeding now. Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, from WFA-TV in Dallas, what you're about to see is the first eyewitness report that we could line up. This program went on the air in Dallas, Texas, approximately 10 minutes after the president was shot. Then after that, we will have film that is completely unedited that was made, and we do not know what's on the film. So right now, let's run the videotape of the program this morning with the eyewitness. Let's go. About 10 or 15 minutes ago, a tragic thing, from all indications at this point, has happened in the city of Dallas. Let me quote to you this. And you'll excuse me if I am out of breath. A bulletin, this is from the United Press, from Dallas. President Kennedy and Governor John Connally have been cut down by assassins' bullets in downtown Dallas. They were riding in an open automobile when the shots were fired. The president, his limp body carried in the arms of his wife, Jacqueline, has rushed to Parkland Hospital. And if you'll excuse me if I give some directions and we talk about what we're going to do here for the next few minutes, but Bobby, let's tape this, if you please, particularly the interview with the eyewitness people. It is being taped. Good. Here's a piece of copy that was rushed to me and was torn off from the United Press in Dallas. President Kennedy has been shot in Dallas, Texas. He was shot as a motorcade left downtown Dallas. Mrs. Kennedy jumped up and grabbed the president. She cried, oh no, as the motorcade sped on. An Associated Press photographer, James Algens, 8LTGENS, reports he saw blood on the president's head. The AP man said he heard two shots but thought someone was shooting fireworks until he saw the blood on the president. He also said he saw no one with a gun. We were awfully close, Jerry Haynes, as you know, and Mr. Peppermint, we were awfully close to being an eyewitness. We were standing on Houston Street between Main and the next street over. Jerry, come in, would you please? And the next street over, we watched the president come by and gave him the applaud that is due the office of the President of the United States. And as he turned left, two or three shots rang out. We thought they were firecrackers until the last shot rang out and we heard people screaming. And we rushed over in time to see a policeman standing behind one of the fire poles, looking around as if for some place to shoot, someone to shoot at. I'd like to remind you here that as the news comes in to the newsroom, we will be on the air. We'll have our eyewitness people here in just a moment. Vicki, would you see if they need some coffee or something? These people are awfully shaken up. They come awfully close. They were in the line of fire. Jer?
I remember, Jay, you said, I thought it was, you know,
firecracker
or something like that, and then they followed one shot, and then a second or two later, another shot, and then another second or
the
two,
third
and then
one.
The third shot, and you said the man's been shot at, and we both turned.
No, I said, my God, that's gunshot.
That's right. Oh. And then we turned right over, we were behind Mr. Dealey's statue,
right.
And we ran over to the cement wall, and we saw people beginning to scatter in places, and I believe our eyewitness
right.
was on the ground.
Chair, would you do me a favor? Would you go check in the newsroom now, and as the men come in from the field, or if they have stories, please let me know, and also get someone to check with. We were supposed to take the feed from KRLD. They may still be doing a feed from there. Check and let me know. And until our news crew gets back in, we will sort of use this studio as our headquarters. These people, and you will excuse me, I don't want to interrupt you. I'm so sorry because I know that you are so upset, but I would like to talk to you for a minute. It's a little bit awkward, so the camera shots will have to fall as they may. I'm going to stand right here, and maybe somebody can give me a chair while we're doing this. May I have your name, please, sir?
Bill Newman.
And this is Mrs. Newman?
Yes, sir.
And this is?
James Clayton.
James, and this is?
Billy.
Billy, tell me what you saw and what you felt. What happened to you?
We just come from Love Field after seeing the president and the first lady, and we were just in front of the triple underpass on Elm Street, and we're at the edge of the curve getting ready to wave at the president.
So you were down under the viaduct, so to speak, weren't you?
Well, we were halfway in between
on the grass,
triple underpass. We were at the curve when the incident happened, but the president's car was some 50 feet still yet
in front
of us coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the president, I don't know who was hit first, but the president jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker because he looked, you know, fair. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall. I don't know what you call it.
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct, and as you turn, going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. You should think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president, is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, a little mound of ground there, the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit, mm-hmm. and he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, we've seen that. I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Oh, yes, sir, it was awful.
It is awful.
That's all.
What kind of work do you do, sir?
I'm a construction worker, electrician.
Is this the first time that you have seen a president of the United States? Did you see him when he was here before in 1961?
No, sir.
Uh-huh.
No, sir.
Your housewife?
Yes, sir.
Took the day off to come downtown and see the president?
Yes, sir, we did. We wanted our children to see it.
Mm-hmm. Were you in the line of fire? I noticed, I remember vividly whenever I walked over and looked over the banister there and saw across the street that you were down on the ground to keep out of the line of fire. What was the first thought that struck your mind?
I thought it was a firecracker, and I saw the blood, and I had the baby, and I just ran, and I got on top of him and laid on the grass. It just scared me. It was terrible.
Did you see anyone else hit besides the...
Governor Connally was kind of turned to the side, and he grabbed his stomach.
Okay. I'd like to remind you that this is Jay Watson. I'm speaking to you from the studios of WFAA-TV in Dallas. The tape that you just have witnessed was played back approximately 10 minutes on our station after the president was shot this afternoon in Dallas. The tape of the eyewitness, there were others. The two people, as you could see, we were in a state of confusion there at the moment, but at least we did have the eyewitness report for you in case you have tuned in late. Government sources in Washington say that President Kennedy is dead. He was shot at approximately 12:35 this afternoon in Dallas, Texas. The gentleman on my left and on your right is Bert Shipp, who is in charge of the photographers in our newsroom. And Bert, you have some film. Just a minute. Bobby, is the film ready to roll yet?
Hello.
No, they're queuing up the film now that Bert took at Parkland Hospital, as I understand it.
Jay, it's going to start out some brief scenes at the Market Hall, okay, or at Trademark, where the president was due to arrive. It's about probably a mile from the scene of the downtown shooting. And, of course, we had no word at Market Hall as to what went on downtown.
Roll the film.
And it was a complete mystery. The police didn't even know. But we knew... As you'll see by halfway through the film, the police went on past the Market Hall area, or Trademark rather, and on it to Parkland Hospital.
Bob, whenever you're ready, go ahead and roll and let's see what we got. Excuse me. No.
Oh, this is a shot. There we go. Here's Market, there's Market Hall. Trademark is right across the street from there. They had a big welcome sign for the president there at the corner of Industrial and Stemmons. It says, "Welcome, Jackie." And
now, this was the place where the president was supposed to make his speech.
Here's some a gentleman carrying signs. I guess you'd call them gentlemen. They had these signs. They weren't causing any trouble. They were run off moments after this, told that there was private property and they couldn't be around there. And they wouldn't talk to us other than they said their signs spoke for themselves. Here's some of the crowd, 450 extra policemen called on duty. Everybody waited anxiously and waited and waited and waited. Here's the policeman ushering a fellow by the name of Joyner from Grand Prairie back across the street. The boys had their mouths taped up so they wouldn't be able to answer any questions. Now there goes the president on up the hill there. He's been, this is after we found out there was something wrong. And
speeding past.
Yeah, them. And here's the disappointed crowd left there at the Trademark. I went up on the roadway there to ask some policemen. Here we go to the hospital. There's homicide detectives in front of us. There's Parkland Hospital. There's the entrance. Police cars all over the place. There is Congressman Wright. He's teary-eyed, as you could imagine. And there's the presidential limousine. The Secret Service men shaking it over. There's
Wright again.
Wright and Yarbrough.
Yarbrough.
There's the Secret Service man is taking its type of a mattress or something out of the back of the car there. And there's Chief Curry. He just couldn't believe it. He had put everything he had into this visit and gave the men all types of instruction. There's inside of a car. I don't know, well, that must have been Conley's car. There's some more shots of the, everybody waiting expectantly. At this time, no one knew anything. And there goes Ms. Lincoln, the president's press secretary, inside. And there's Yarborough again, Senator Yarborough. And he says the sight was too gruesome to describe. And there's a final parting shot from Parkman.
The film of, and the quality of the film, of course, you can understand, and also the fact that it was not edited. This gentleman is Bob Walker, news director of WFAA Television. Bob, do you have some last-minute items there?
Just this, that the vice president is on his way to Washington, where he will be sworn in. The president's children are on the second floor of the White House and have not been told as yet that their father was killed. And the White House news staff is under a state of complete, White House staff, I should say, is under a state of complete collapse. First reports said that President Kennedy was shot from an overpass. Our WFAA TV reporter, Mal Couch, saw the gun emerge from the upper story of the warehouse, which has turned out to be the second floor of the Texas Book Depository, which is a familiar sign.
Let me interrupt you here. This is Jay Watson and Bob Walker, WFA-TV in Dallas. Let's switch now to ABC in New York.
This is Ron Cochran at the ABC News headquarters in New York. Just to recapitulate what most of you, I'm sure, already know by now, President Kennedy is dead. The 35th President of the United States, born May 29, 1917 in Boston, the first Catholic president ever elected. He was also the youngest man ever elected president. He was the first American chief executive to face the possibility of nuclear warfare. He risked it with a show of force to protect American interests. Later, he succeeded in achieving an accord with Russia limiting nuclear tests, and that occurred only recently. Now we go to Washington for a direct report from Ed Morgan.
This is Edward P. Morgan in Washington. I have just come from the White House. The president is dead. The word came to the White House from a doctor in Dallas. The scene in the White House is a mixture of stunned disbelief, anger, and heartbreak. I saw McGeorge Bundy, the president's chief advisor on international security affairs. His eyes were red-rimmed. He was silent. He shook my hands in silence. By coincidence, I happened to have lunch with Ralph Dungan, one of the president's other top advisors. We drove back to the White House together. On our way back, we saw clots of students at George Washington University standing in the street, listening to the horrible news on the radio. When I got to the White House, secretaries were sobbing audibly in the corridors. Charles Horsky, the president's advisor for District of Columbia Affairs, was walking back and forth in the corridor with his hands beating his forehead. Hubert Humphrey happened to be at the lunch that Dungan and I attended at the Chilean embassy, where we both got the news. The senator's first reaction was one of high indignation, and his audible reaction was unprintable. He immediately went to the Senate, where the news had already been given. There is no official spokesman, ironically enough, at the White House at this moment. Pierre Salinger, the president's press secretary, is not in Texas, but at last reports was on the way in the air from Honolulu to Tokyo with Secretary of State Dean Rusk. At this moment, it seems hardly the time, and yet the inexorability of events make it necessary to report what the order of events is now. Vice President Lyndon Johnson will be the next president of the United States. According to the processes of law, he must be sworn in as soon as possible. Calvin Coolidge was sworn in New England at midnight, as I recall, after Warren Harding had died in San Francisco of blood poisoning. Harry Truman was sworn in, you may remember, in Washington in April 1945, after Franklin D. Roosevelt had died of a stroke in Warm Springs, Georgia. This news at this point has so stunned the Capitol that there is no rational progression of events. Nobody is thinking about much of anything except the indescribable, incredible fact that the man who came out of Fort Worth with his customary PT boat vigor at 7 o'clock this morning, made two speeches in Fort Worth, and then went on to Dallas, is now a man in his 46th year, the youngest president of the United States ever to be elected as such, the first Roman Catholic ever to be elected as such, is dead. This is Edward P. Morgan in Washington.
You got it, New York.
This is Ron Cochran in the ABC News headquarters in New York. Senators, we're told, crowded around two news tickers waiting for word of the shooting. Many of the senators remained slumped in their seats on the floor until Senate Democratic leaders called the Senate back into session. Senator Richard Russell of Georgia said the whole nation is shocked by this dastardly crime. And after a 15-minute recess, the Senate returned and had the Reverend Frederick Brown Harris, Senate chaplain, say a prayer. The Senate adjourned after the chaplain's prayer that President Kennedy's life might be spared. That, of course, was before word came that he had already died. Vice President Johnson's office says it has no information to confirm rumors that Johnson has been wounded in the shooting. That, however, was an earlier word, and evidently the Vice President was not injured, according to all the information we have. We were told from Dallas a few minutes ago that the Vice President is already on his way back to Washington. Possibly he is attempting to get back to the airport. I doubt that he has had time to leave Dallas. In any event, according to the best information we have, Vice President Johnson will not take the oath of office as president until he returns to Washington. On the seventh floor of the Hotel Commodore here in New York, where the Democratic State Committee has headquarters, about a dozen women, including members of the staff, broke into tears. All normal activities ceased in the hotel, and in nearby office buildings, they were crowded around radio and television sets, as I'm sure millions of persons are all over the country by this time. And incidentally, you may have seen, of course, a good deal of confusion in our reports. Quite naturally, all of us in the television and radio industry were taken quite by surprise by this event. Obviously, no one could possibly in his wildest dream have imagined that such a thing would happen. The word came, of course, that the shooting had taken place during the normal lunchtime here in New York, and all of us at all the networks rushed back from wherever we were at the time and got on the air as quickly as possible. And we are still operating under more or less emergency and impromptu conditions, but we are staying on the air to bring you the news, every bit of information as it comes to us from the wire services and from our own reporters in Dallas and in Washington. We have just received word that Assistant Presidential Press Secretary Malcolm Kilduff confirms that Johnson, that is, Vice President Johnson, was not hit by the rifle fire. The new president previously had been reported wounded. So I think that there is no doubt now that Lyndon Johnson is all right. He was not injured in the shooting. Mayor Wagner, here in New York, was at a luncheon club when he received the news. He reported he was watching the news of the shooting on television, described the event as a terrible thing. We'll be receiving various comments by dignitaries and others all over the country. The only thing, of course, that all of us can say at this time is that this was a shocking, shocking thing, something which no one could have imagined would happen, and yet it has. President Kennedy was the first president to be assassinated since William McKinley was shot, and that was in 1901, 62 years ago. And this is the first death of a president in office since Franklin D. Roosevelt died of a cerebral hemorrhage at Warm Springs, Georgia, in April 1945. There have been only, I guess in this century, only three other presidents have been shot at. Besides McKinley, there was an attempt on the life of Franklin D. Roosevelt, in which Mayor Cermak of Chicago was killed. And there was an attempt on the life by a group of Puerto Rican nationalists in Washington on the life of President Truman while he was staying in Blair House at the time that White House was being rebuilt. That was in 1950. Two Puerto Rican nationalists tried to gun their way into Blair House and assassinate Mr. Truman. who was taking a nap at the time on the second floor. One White House police officer was killed in that shooting and another seriously wounded. One of the assassins was killed in a blaze of gunfire on Pennsylvania Avenue, right across the street from the White House. Guarding the president, of course, obviously is a very hazardous occupation. One of the Secret Service men with traveling with President Kennedy was killed by the gunfire today. We have not received word that any others were wounded. Governor John Connally of Texas underwent an operation for the gunshot wound. He was struck in the chest. He was operated on at 2:30 p.m. today. His condition is said to be serious. It's not described as critical, but serious. The governor was not out of the woods, according to the doctors. They say that the vital signs are good, however. The doctor said Governor Connally had a good pulse. His respiration was satisfactory. According to eyewitnesses, Governor Connally and President Kennedy fell simultaneously. We do not know, of course, at this time whether that indicates that they were both felled by the same bullet, which was fired by a sniper. According to our reporters in Dallas, someone saw the muzzle of a gun emerge from a window in a warehouse building along the parade route, or not far from the parade route. We don't know how many shots were fired. There were more than one, possibly three or four. Do you have any further information, Ed Silverman? Have you received any?
Reports. We've got the phone open here, Ron. We have expectancy of a report from Bob Clark any moment. He, of course, was traveling with the presidential party. Here's something just in. It's a report out of Washington, of course, reporting that six members of President Kennedy's cabinet were out of the country flying to Japan when the president was killed today. They were an hour and a half out of Honolulu. The secretaries were advised of the killing, and of course, they immediately turned back. They're expected to speed directly back to Washington. Now, this party was on its way to a meeting with members of the Japanese cabinet. Now, in the party en route were Secretary of State Rusk, Secretary of Commerce Hodges, Secretary of Labor Wirtz, and Secretary of the Interior Udall, and Secretary of Agriculture Freeman. Their wives accompanied them. Of course, when they heard the news, they turned directly back.
I think it's fair to say that President Kennedy's administration is perhaps one of the most traveling administrations of all time, partly because of the availability of jet planes and therefore the relative ease of travel, but also because it was part of the pattern of President Kennedy's method of operating. He liked to travel. He liked to go to the scene where things were happening, and to see and hear for himself. And partly because of the president's own inclinations in those directions, there was a great deal of traveling done by him and his staff, but also he surrounded himself with people who seemed to like to travel. And it is ironic that this event should occur at a time when the White House staff, the official White House staff, was largely depleted. You heard earlier that Pierre Salinger, the president's news secretary, was on his way to Tokyo, and many of the other top-ranking officials of the White House were not at their desks, not even in Washington, so that this did perhaps slow up the transmission of news, considering the president somewhat. We have word that the Russian news agency, TASS, carried a flash on its international English language radio teletype circuit at 2:45 p.m. today. The flash said it has just been officially announced that United States President John F. Kennedy has died in a hospital after an attempt was made on his life by persons as believed from among the extreme right-wing elements. The identity of the assassin or assassins, we do not know whether it's more than one person. The identity has not been established. Sheriff's officers in Dallas took a young man into custody at the scene and questioned him behind closed doors, we're told. And a Dallas television reporter said he saw a rifle being withdrawn from a window. You heard that on our broadcast here a few minutes ago. He said it was on the fifth or sixth floor of an office building shortly after the gunfire. Kennedy was shot at 1:25 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We go now to Don Goddard. With me in the studio here is a man who spent 8 years with as press secretary for President Eisenhower and is used to the precautions taken by for the president's safety. And he is Jim Haggerty, now vice president of ABC Paramount Pictures. Jim, what security measures would have been taken in this case?
Well, Don, whenever the president goes anyplace, there is always an advance party of Secret Service men that go out into the area. They work closely with the local municipal police, with the sheriff's department in the county, and with the state police. They make the advance preparations.
Yep.
During a motorcade where this terrible thing happened, there is always the driver of the presidential car is a member of the Secret Service.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Jim. We'll get back to this. Fine. We have a phone call from Bob Clark in Dallas. Back to Ron Cochran.
Stand by, please.
Hey, Nick.
Bob, stand by, please. We were having a little technical difficulty. All right, Bob. Yes, we are on the air now, Bob. Would you give us a recap of all that you know, please?
Well, first, the president's body has just been taken to Parkland Memorial Hospital to a Dallas funeral home. The body in a sealed brown casket was wheeled out of the emergency ward where the president has been since he was admitted to the hospital about an hour and a half ago. Mrs. Kennedy walked quietly by the side of the casket as it was placed in an ambulance waiting outside the hospital.
Bob, there have been reports that there was a possibility that Mrs. Kennedy and Mrs. Connolly might have been wounded.
One of the women in the were wounded. There has been a still unconfirmed report that Lyndon Johnson suffered a heart attack sometime after the shooting. The only thing I could add to this, I was at the side of the president's limousine when the president's body was lifted out of the car and placed on a stretcher and taken into the emergency ward. At that time, oddly, the vice president appeared to be clutching his chest. He preceded the president into the hospital, which seemed an unusual thing to do. Normally, you would have expected that he would have stood at the side of the president. So this might lend some credence to the reports that the vice president may have suffered a heart attack.
Is he now en route to Washington?
We understand he is en route to Washington. We have this further word from Mrs. Johnson, who left the hospital here about a half an hour ago. Said only one word when she was asked about the vice president, and that was that he was fine.
Has anyone seen Mrs. Kennedy recently? How is she taking it? Is she in a state of shock? Is she under sedation?
She walked within a half dozen feet of me just 3 or 4 minutes ago as the president's body was taken out of the hospital. I didn't get a clear look at her face. Obviously, she is grief-stricken at this stage, but she was walking calmly by the side of the casket as it was carried out of the hospital and placed in an ambulance.
All right, Bob, just to recap this, would you give us the very latest that you have on the president and the situation there and some of the reaction there, too? I know it's been quite a shock to all.
Well, actually, we have gotten little official word from the White House. We got the announcement something like a half an hour ago that the president was dead. There has still been no official words from the doctors who were in attendance. It's known, of course, that the president was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple. I can recap briefly the tragic chain of events. The presidential motorcade had just swept through downtown Dallas. The crowds couldn't have been friendlier, couldn't have been more cordial or more enthusiastic. They were extremely large. There must have been at least 150,000, probably more than that, along the route of the motorcade from Love Airport in Dallas through downtown Dallas. We had just rounded the corner at the fringe of the business district when three shots suddenly rang out, but they sounded at this stage like an automobile backfiring. They were extremely loud. I was in a car as a pool man for the American Radio and Television Networks, was in a car, just three cars behind the president. We heard the shots very clearly, but it was almost inconceivable at that stage that this was an assassination. About no more than 2 or 3 seconds elapsed before the car that the president was traveling, this was an open limousine that had been sent out from the White House fleet in Washington. This car came to an immediate stop. The Secret Service follow car. Some of the agents piled out. Then almost immediately leaped back in. We saw one of them pull out a submachine gun. They leaped back into the car, and the motorcade took off very rapidly. It had just entered a throughway. The motorcade did something like 60 miles an hour to Parkman Memorial Hospital, which is some 3 or 4 miles away. The car I was in kept up with the motorcade. We were some 50 feet behind the car carrying the president when he entered the hospital grounds. We, of course, all got out of the car and went immediately to the side of his car. At that point, the president was lying prone in the back seat of the car, his head cradled by Mrs. Kennedy. He was holding one hand over his head. Apparently, he had, when he had been shot, he had clutched his hand to his face. He was absolutely motionless. I think someone who was more experienced at this sort of disaster might have recognized immediately that the president had been mortally wounded. I stood at the side of the car for some a minute or two while a stretcher was wheeled out. During this period, the president made no motion at all. The first lady again sat rather holding his head. Then he was lifted by 3 or 4 Secret Service agents, again with Mrs. Kennedy standing by, actually pulling on to him during this period. He was lifted by the agents and placed on the stretcher, wheeled immediately into the emergency ward of the hospital. At this point, Governor Connally, who had also, of course, been shot and is still in critical condition, was lying sort of half stretched out in the front seat of this the same open limousine. The only persons besides the Secret Service agents in the car with the president were Governor Governor Connally, and the First Lady. When the president was wheeled into the hospital, Governor Connally was still lying again half stretched out on the front seat of the car. I was surprised at this stage. I had noticed while we were waiting for the stretcher to be wheeled up for Mr. Kennedy, the vice president, who had been traveling in a car behind the president, had gotten out, and with someone by his side, the vice president appeared to be clutching his chest. He walked into the hospital, perhaps a minute or so before Mr. Kennedy was placed aboard the... There have since, of course, been unconfirmed reports that the vice president has suffered a heart attack. From the time the president arrived at the hospital, we went through almost an hour without any medical word at all. The corridor where he had been wheeled into the emergency ward was closed off to all but the Secret Service agents. Senator Yarbrough of Texas, who had also been in the procession and in the car with Lynn Johnson, sat weeping quietly in a small hospital room off the corridor. The Secret Service maintained extremely strict precautions during this stage. No one, and that meant absolutely no one, was permitted down the corridor within 50 of the emergency room where the president then lay. The official word that the president was dead was, this announcement was made in the lobby of the White House almost an hour after he had been shot. The only development since that time, and we have still had no further medical details from any of the doctors in attendance, the only further development came just a few minutes ago when the president, the bronze casket bearing the president's body, was out of the hospital, placed in an ambulance and taken to a Dallas funeral home.
All right, Bob, we're going to do something rather unorthodox, but the circumstances call for it. We want you to proceed to a radio station, TV station, WFAA, and give us your reports from there. Call us on our number of Susquehanna 75,000, extension 385. Those are your instructions, Bob. Thank you very much for the report.
Until we have somebody else here at the hospital, or someone else getting development out, I would not do that at this stage.
Okay, we'll abide by your decision then, Bob. You keep us posted. Anytime you have anything fresh, give us a call. We'll put you on.
Okay, fine.
Okay, fine. Thank you. That was Bob Clark and Del.
TV you were just taking, huh? Next.
You're on the air, Bob, so we hear you. Thank you very much, Bob.
Fine, thanks.
And we'll hear from you later. That was Bob Clark in Dallas. Let's go now to Don Goddard.
With me here in the studio is Jim Haggerty, who spent 8 years as press secretary of President Eisenhower, as you know, and who had a hand in the planning of many motorcades like this to prevent the very thing, the very greatest dread of the thing that has happened today. Jim is now vice president of ABC. Jim, what precautions normally would be taken, and why did they break down in this case?
Well, I don't think they broke down. There is always an advance Secret Service detail that goes to any city and works with the local police, the sheriff's office, the state police in protecting the line of route. But when a president of the United States or any official of our country is traveling in an open car, you cannot guard every single window. You cannot guard every single building. So you have to go for a show of force, an obvious show of police protection. In an open car, or in any car that the president rides in, the driver is a Secret Service man, and the man in the front seat is a Secret Service man. Immediately following the presidential car, there is at least one, and sometimes two, follow-up Secret Service cars. The drivers of those cars are members of the Secret Service, and the occupants are Secret Service and special assigned men from the municipal police force or the state police force or the sheriff's office. I have seen many motorcades, talked to many officials of law enforcement agencies throughout our country and around the world, and each of them say the same thing, a rifle shot, particularly from a window of a building, is pretty tough to guard against. But the President of the United States, a man in that office, has to be completely fatalist about his own welfare.
And fearless.
And fearless. And all of our presidents, I think, have been that way. The very fact that at least a suspect has been seized shows that the security was working to a certain point. But this has happened. Attempts have happened before. Ron Cochran has reported the other events in front of Blair House in 1950 with President Truman, in Miami with President-elect Roosevelt. But the thing that this one, a little different than any others, was that this was a rifle apparently used with a marksman. In the past, there are only one other man outside of the Puerto Ricans who fired at a president that knew how to shoot a firearm was John Wilkes Booth. All of the other attempts on the lives of the presidents have been by screwballs who have fired a gun for the first time in their life at a president of the United States.
Jim, we now have some film, fresh film in Dallas, and we will go to our Dallas newsroom for that.
Jay Watson and Bob Walker at WFAA-TV in Dallas, the ABC News Information Center for this area. The eyes of the nation and the hearts of the nation are with Mrs. Kennedy today, and the eyes of Dallas, Texas are held in shame. We have a film available that was, excuse me, Bob, go ahead.
May report this bulletin that a Secret Service agent and a Dallas policeman were shot and killed here today. They were shot some distance from the area where President Kennedy was assassinated. No other information immediately available from there, except one more point here that this Secret Service Lieutenant Eric Kaminsky has said the assassin's weapon appears to have been a high-powered Army or Japanese rifle of .25 caliber. The entire building where the sniper was located was evacuated. If we could get a picture of our map here and show somewhere of the building, it was a Texas school book depository, which means exactly what it says.
This is the car where the president was. This is what we call our triple underpass in Dallas. This is the grassy area where, and it was originally thought that the shots came from him here. And now it's believed that the shots came from this building here. We have a film now, and by the way, we have the one of the men, someone, and I should say someone, has been arrested in one of the downtown theaters. They don't know if it was the man who shot the policeman or the person who actually shot President Kennedy and Governor Connally. It's in our process. It's being processed now. We'll have that just as soon as possible. Right now, we have an interview with an investigating officer, so let's roll that film, please.
Oh, no.
You saw a man up there.
That's where the guy was.
Open my mic. This is the, of course you realize that the film is unedited and this is one of the parts of the film without the sound on it. This film was made in one of the investigators' offices here in Dallas and we will have the interview in just a few moments. I'd like to repeat that we will have some videotape later in the day of the president's arrival at Love Field in Dallas at approximately 11:35 this morning, and 1 hour later the president was shot.
This is film in Sheriff Bill Decker's office.
Sheriff of Dallas County. The city of Dallas, well, I know...
Here. Sound.
Yeah, can I have your name?
J.H. Sawyer.
And your position?
Inspector, please.
What is the story here now? This is apparently the building that the assassin shot from.
This is the building that the witnesses said they had seen a man up there and some with a rifle. And also we found some empty rifle shells on the fifth floor.
So he would have been directly above us?
Directly above us. Indications were that he had been there for some time.
Well, has the police department taken any precautions against such an incident?
We thought we had taken all of the precautions that were necessary. But this particular building was not covered, as were a lot of other buildings.
So as it stands now, there is a suspect. There were witnesses.
There are witnesses who saw the man.
What did they see as far as the president and the governor?
Well, several of the witnesses saw him slump over.
The president?
Yes.
And the governor?
And the governor, yes.
You also understand the Secret Service man was in?
This I do not know. I haven't received that information.
How many policemen are there in the city of Dallas?
We have approximately 1,300.
I would assume they're all out right now.
Yes, bulletin here. Police have arrested a white man in the Riverside section of Fort Worth in connection with the shooting of a Dallas policeman. The man has denied any connection with the assassination of President Kennedy.
Of course, there will be a lot of stories coming in like that. Everybody that's picked up here will be in some way or another connected. We do not know at this moment in Dallas, from the latest word we've gotten from our reporters, from the police chief, and from the sheriff's department, if any of the people arrested so far are actually the person who pulled the trigger. It seems like that the building that the shot was fired from is a building used by the state of Texas to store school books. It's an old building, a building that would be hard to cover. It stands over the viaduct as the, I guess there are 15 or 20 different places throughout the building that someone could be hiding to take a shot. I don't know of anything I'd like to speak here for the city of Dallas. We are ashamed at the moment. We are stunned. The whole world is stunned, but at this moment, I don't think anybody could be more stunned than the people who live in our city. We have, only a few weeks ago, when Adlai Stevenson was here, and you're all familiar with the incidents that took place there, and all of us were commenting this morning, and all of us for the last few days have been commenting that we hope nothing would happen to bring disgrace to Dallas. The messages are coming in to our newsroom from all over the state, coming in from all over the world. We will have, how do we stand on our film, Bob? Have you been able to check?
It's being developed now.
Be about 6 or 8 minutes before we do have. In the meantime, let's show the videotape of the president arriving.
Queuing, that's why he's queuing down.
Beg your pardon?
He's queuing.
There's one moment here. We're queuing. We have the videotape of the president arriving this morning. Is that correct? Okay. We are now queuing up the videotape of the president's arrival in Dallas this morning, Bob.
I couldn't help but I was at the airport broadcasting the arrival. Couldn't help but mention how thrilled the crowds were that the president broke away from his normal routine and rushed up to the fences and shook hands with the hundreds of people. Estimate now somewhere between 1,500 and 2,000 people at Love Field. And I couldn't help but remark how at great spirits he was in and his wife. Their Texas reception thus far had been just wonderful. Better than suspected in Houston, perhaps not quite as good in San Antonio, I think above all expectations in Fort Worth. This morning he had stepped out in the parking lot and talked to 8,000 people in Fort Worth, and his wife wasn't along. A few people were disappointed. The president very jokingly remarked, "Well, it takes Jackie a little longer to get prettied up than it does me." And that's where she is now, he told the crowd. Then he went inside and addressed the breakfast meeting over there at the Texas Hotel where they had spent the night, and then came on into Dallas. And the Dallas reception was just tremendous at Love Field. The crowds are roaring and cheering and straining forward to get a good look at the president. And then he and his wife broke away and came up smiling to the fences, walked all along that fence. And now let's see it. I think the videotape is ready of the president's arrival here this morning. There he is.
He's waving at a lot of people, smiling, Secret Service men all around. Boy, this is something. They break right away and come right up to the fence, and the people who waited all morning in this fence are rewarded with a glimpse, and a lot of them with a close look and a handshake with the President of the United States and his wife. And he's coming right down toward us and toward our fine camera positions here. The press is having a field day. Somebody perched up on somebody's shoulders. Secret Service right along with the president, of course. The president passes right in front of a Dallas police officer, right in front of our cameras now. Somebody patted his shoulder. Mrs. Kennedy coming along behind him, grinning all the while. President saying, "Thank you very much. If I may be permitted to read a presidential lip movement." This is a bonus for the people who have waited out here. Now, Mrs. Kennedy, right along behind him. President still moving over towards some phone booths that were set up for the press. The people surging up toward that fence. But there is a fence, and the president waves goodbye, waits for his wife, and back they go to the car. Governor Connally standing in the car, beaming.
Set. Show quite distinctly the Secret Service coverage of the president. There are three or four Secret Service men right behind the president and Mrs. Kennedy, as Mrs. Kennedy now gets into the car, and the president does. The other man in the car is the governor of Texas. And the Secret Service men are now getting in the driver and the front seat. The other members of the detail have apparently left to go into the follow-up car, which is the car immediately, which will be the car immediately behind the president's car in the motorcade. Mrs. Kennedy and the president, as you can see, are leaving. The governor of Texas is in the jump seat right directly in front of the president. And the wife of the governor of Texas is sitting in front of Mrs. Kennedy. The Secret Service are following the car out. They're standing on the running board of the follow-up car, and as is their custom, until the president's car picks up speed, usually about 20 miles an hour, run alongside of the car. When the car is moving, the Secret Service drop back, jump into the follow-up car, and stay right with him. The driver of the follow-up car keeps his car about no more than 10 feet at the maximum, and usually about 6 feet behind the presidential car at all times, regardless of the speed of the president's car and the speed of the motorcade. The other cars that you see there, I would imagine, are cars for dignitaries. and cause for the press corps that follows with the president. One of the cars in the motorcade is a pool car of representatives of the combined news media. There again, you can see the Secret Service in the follow-up car standing on the running board. That car, by the way, has very heavy armaments in it. It has submachine guns. It has the necessary. And now, as you see, the president's car is leaving. I return you now to Dallas.
A gentleman just walked in our studio that I am meeting for the first time, as well as you. This is WFAA-TV in Dallas, Texas. May I have your name, please, sir?
My name is Abraham Zapruder.
Mr. Zapruder?
Zapruder, yes, sir.
Zapruder. And would you tell us your story, please, sir?
I got out in, about a half hour earlier and get into a good spot to shoot some pictures. And I found a spot, one of these concrete blocks that I have down near that park near the underpass. And I got on top there. There was another girl from my office. She was right behind me. And as I was shooting, as the president was coming down from Houston Street making his turn, it was about halfway down there, I had a shot. And he slumped to the side like this. Then I had another shot or two. I couldn't say whether it was one or two. And I saw his head practically open up, all blood and everything. And I kept on shooting. That's about all. I'm just sick again.
I think that pretty well expresses the entire feelings of
terrible,
the whole world.
Terrible.
You have the film in your camera. We'll try.
Yes,
to get,
I brought it on the studio. Now.
We'll try to get that processed and have it as soon as possible. Right now, we have videotape. A picture of the building of where the bullet came from. Let's take the picture first, then the videotape. This is videotape now. This is a picture of the hearse leaving Parkland Hospital with President Kennedy's body. As I understand it, the body is being taken to one of the funeral homes here in Dallas. That, Bob, that pretty well covers it, I think. This is the same hospital that President Kennedy visited in his visit here in 1961. It is not? Excuse me. This is the outside shot of the hospital and the people who are gathered there, all stunned in the realization that President Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, Texas today. Now we have a picture of the building. There's a picture of the building that one of the boys took, showing possibly one of the windows that was used. The top right hand. Okay, which one was it? Let's see if we can figure it out.
No.
There it is. There is a picture of the window where the gun was allegedly fired from that killed President Kennedy
in the line of fire
today. Excuse me, go ahead, sir.
I must have been the line of fire where I see now the picture where I was. I was right on that concrete block, as I said. And as I explained before, it was a sickening scene. At first, I thought perhaps it's a. It sounded like somebody make a joke. You hear a shot and somebody grabs their stomach.
I was about 100 yards away from one of our other, the boy and I walked over to see President Kennedy. We were about 100 yards away, and it sounded like there were three shots. And after the first couple, I said, my God, they've shot the president. And then we walked over and looked down and could see the people on the grass there. And I imagine you were one of the people that we saw there underneath the viaduct. This happened this afternoon about, 12:35, the president died.
Something like it was at
1 o'clock. They sounded like, at first they sounded like firecrackers, and somebody next to us said they're shooting off fireworks, but then we realized, it didn't take but a minute to realize that they were loud reports, and for those of you who are familiar with hearing a rifle shot, it was. recognizable sound. The videotape that we have, Bobby, what do you have now? Okay, that completes the videotape coverage for the moment. We will have film back in about 15 minutes of the arrest of a person who could be the person who shot the policeman or the Secret Service man or Connally or President Kennedy, and we'll have that in just a moment. Now let's go back to ABC in New York.
It has been little more than an hour since President Kennedy has been pronounced dead. In New York, ABC's Don Goddard is talking with Jim Haggerty, who was former President Eisenhower's press secretary. In just a few minutes, the world will hear the name Lee Harvey Oswald for the first time as more information on the assassination becomes known.
Jim, the Dallas Sheriff's Department has found a rifle on the fifth floor staircase of that building we just saw in the picture. The book storage place. It's a 7.65 Mauser, German-made army rifle, telescopic sight, and one shell left in the chamber. Three spent shells have been found nearby, and apparently they're hooking this as the murder weapon. This is from one of those windows up in the top.
Well, Don, as I said a little earlier, I think this, like the Puerto Rican attempt in front of Blair House in 1950, has to be a planned conspiracy. This is the first time in our history when a rifle has been used and fired at a president of the United States. From the photographs of the building, that carry must have been a couple of hundred yards. And whoever fired it must have been a man that could handle a rifle with a telescopic sight. And I understand they found the rifle and had a telescopic sight on it. All of the other attempts, both assassinations and attempts, outside of the Puerto Rican one, was done with a pistol. And with the exception of John Wilkes Booth, the assassins of a president fired a revolver at the president for the first time they ever fired a gun. So this must have been a very carefully planned, terrible tragedy and conspiracy. Again, talking about the security matters, in a large city, it is impossible to guard every single window. In the years that I served with General Eisenhower, the only time I ever saw all windows guarded in a line of march was at Tehran, when President Eisenhower went to visit the Shah of Iran. And as you might remember, along about that time, his life had been publicly threatened by the members of the communist conspiracy throughout the world. And they turned out their whole army. And every single window on that line of march in the city was guarded by either an army or a policeman. But that was the only time I've ever seen that.
You felt pretty well covered that time.
You felt very well covered. But in a city, it's impossible. In a city the size of Dallas or New York, you just can't guard every single window. But it happened, and these are the risks that a president always takes. I'm sure that every single president, I know President Eisenhower personally, in the back of his mind always realized that there was a chance where some vindictive person or a screwball or somebody like that would take a shot at him.
It's bootless, Jim, to talk about what might have happened, but would that bubble have bounced bullets if it had been closed?
I can't speak with any authority on the bubble that is now used. I can with the bubble that was used by President Eisenhower, and that was not bulletproofed. The bottom of the car that President Eisenhower used, and I would assume is the same with President Kennedy, is armor-plated,
yes.
And that is for grenades that might be tossed or a mine or something like that. But the bubble on President Eisenhower's car was used to protect mainly from the elements, rain or drizzle, so that the people could still see him if it was raining or was drizzling.
Well, this adds one to the case for conspiracy then, and the Dallas police are apparently trying to add another. They've arrested a 24-year-old man, Lee Oswald, in connection with the slaying of the Dallas policeman and presumably the slaying also of the Secret Service man in another part of Dallas, which happened just shortly before the president.
Well, I was interested also, Don, in the reports from Bob Clark that after the shooting happened, the president's car and the follow-up car immediately left in a hurry, left the scene. This, again, is in line with security measures. And if anything happens, they get out of that that place fast in case there are other people in the crowd that are ready.
Yes. Jim, Jules Bergman is down in Times Square for reaction there. We switch to Jules.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Still not receiving anything on the PL. Still not receiving anything on the PL.
This is the scene in Times Square as New Yorkers stand stunned. You can see the sorrow on their faces, I think. There isn't... everyone is waiting to hear what's going to happen next. As if...
using this microphone?
No.
Which isn't in yet?
This is the one you're going to have to use.
This isn't in yet?
No.
How are we going to use this?
Just like this.
We'll switch it. Switch cords. What what are you doing, Moore? This one will be okay.
Disgusting. The New York City Police Commissioner has ordered all policemen to work from 8 o'clock this morning to be held in reserve to 8 o'clock at night to handle the crowds that we have just seen in Times Square. Lou Chiappi is standing by in Paris with the reaction from that stunned nation. We will listen.
One. The news of the assassination of the president has shocked all of France. Here in this Riviera city of Nice, where the leading UNR party is meeting in its national convention, the gay convention mood has given way to one of sorrow. Delegates are sincerely saddened. For despite differences that have existed between our two countries, France has faith in President Kennedy. The words being heard now are terrible tragedy, awful, and the universal attitude is this touches not only the United States, but France and all of the free world. The news struck here in France with a kind of bitter irony. This assassination has been the specter that has been haunting France for years. Three times extremists have tried to take the life as it is called the goal. Three times they failed. And the fatalists have been saying, what if they finally succeed one day? What will happen to our country? Who will be able to follow in the general's footsteps? That same tragic question is now being asked about the United States. Who will be able to follow in the footsteps of John F. Kennedy? General de Gaulle himself is reported to have been deeply saddened by the news. Despite the general's differences with Mr. Kennedy, the general had a deep and faith and respect in President Kennedy. Even when he cast mistrust on the future intentions of the United States, he always made it clear that he was not speaking of John F. Kennedy, that the president would keep his word to defend the free world. In the streets of this Riviera city, in the streets of cities all over France, a kind of gloom has settled the country. Luciotti, ABC.
The late dispatch from Washington says that the president's body will be brought to Washington this afternoon. And Vice President Johnson is expected to be sworn in as President of the United States aboard an airliner before flying immediately back to the nation's capital. Governor John Connally of Texas, who was shot at the same time as President Kennedy, has undergone surgery for the wound in his chest. His condition is serious, but he's believed to have a good chance of recovery. And now back to Dallas for a late report from there.
Jay Watson and Bob Walker at WFAA-TV. In Dallas, we have some late film. Also, we understand that Vice President Lyndon Johnson will be sworn in Dallas. Our video cruiser is on the way. We'll try to have that tape for you later, or at least we will have film coverage of that as soon as possible. Let's roll the film now, Bob, and see what it is.
All right. This is some of the motorcade as it ended its drive just minutes before it rounded the turn at which the president was shot and killed.
Mm-hmm.
some of the people on the streets.
And I, just about a minute, I'd say 45 seconds before the president was shot, I was standing right in here and gave the president the applaud. He turned the corner.
There's the president and Mrs. Kennedy just minutes before he was shot.
Mr. Haggerty explained, too, that that dome was not on, as you can see there.
There now we're getting down.
Right here is where it took place. Just as you saw...
Now, here is the spot where the president was killed. This is the building which the shot was fired. In a minute, you'll see a policeman or someone crawling in the... Where is the window where the shot was fired from? Now you see policemen with guns, suspecting perhaps the man was still in the building.
Bobby, come back to the man.
Bits of chicken, food particles were found in the building, indicating he had been there for some time. The weapon has been found. I do not have the exact make of it. They found it in the sixth floor of this building. I've just learned that. A German Mauser, I believe, is what it was.
That's out in front of the depository, Texas School.
Right, this is just minutes after the president was shot.
The if you remember the picture there where the president turned left and the long shot, it was there that it happened.
Dallas County Sheriff Bill Decker. Policeman with the guns, trained. Have no idea at all what who these people may be. Evidently, they're clearing the area is all I can say. President John F. Kennedy has now been dead an hour and 49 minutes.
This is a scene where President Kennedy was shot this afternoon. Dallas, Texas, picking up one of the
just men there. suspects. By the droves, of course, have been pulled off the streets.
Now, the picture you see now is tracing the route of President Kennedy up Levin Avenue on Turtle Creek. Now we're coming into the main part of Dallas. There's City Hall. He turns left, right on Houston Street, and right there is where the president was shot. The films that you have
the
just
the trademark up the top of the picture is where he was set to give an address at 1 o'clock, incidentally, the minute he expired.
Okay, Bob, I see that Ron Ryland is. Let him scoot in here and tell what he knows. I think he had the film, shot the film of the man that was arrested. Sit down. This is Ron Ryland. You can imagine the confusion that's going on in the city of Dallas today, not only in our newsroom, but in all the newsrooms. Ron, tell us what you know.
Well, I've just come back from Oak Cliff at the Texas Theater on West Jefferson Street.
Let me explain that Oak Cliff is a part of Dallas.
Yes, sir, it is. We joined a police motorcade that was dashing to the Texas Theater, where they had a report of a man coming in there that was armed. Just prior to that, a police officer had been shot in that area, had been shot with a .38 caliber automatic. We went to the scene. About, I would say, 200 or more police officers went into the theater and found a man sitting in the second row from the back that was armed with a shotgun. The
crowd, of course, I imagine, connected this with the slaying of the president.
Yes, sir. Any man, I think, that is armed in Dallas today is a suspect at the moment. The officers converged on this man, grabbed him up, and hustled him out of the theater, all the while he was protesting against the police brutality that they were working him over in one thing and another. They dragged him out. The crowd proceeded to push the officers aside and try to get at the man, screaming murder and all, and they do believe that it was almost a lynch mob.
Ron, did you just shoot the film that we just looked at?
I just got in, Mr. Watson.
No,
I haven't seen
AJ
the film.
AJ Lost.
All right, why don't you bring him in? Let's let him. Let's. We'll run the film again and let AJ talk about it. Excuse me. Go ahead.
All right,
now. Do you know what kind of gun that they found over at the book?
Yes, sir. They have just found the weapon that they believe is the assassination weapon. It is an Argentine 6.5 Mauser that had a four-power scope on it. Also, in this same area, they found a bag of chicken. They found several bottles of soft drink.
Yeah.
And in other words, the man had been planted there for some time.
He could have been there for quite some time.
Yes, sir. I assume that he'd been there for possibly overnight because he did have several things there to eat.
Do you have, excuse me, I've just received word that Lyndon Johnson has been sworn in as President of the United States. More background material on that in just a few moments from New York. I'll repeat, Lyndon Johnson is now President of the United States. He was sworn in just a few minutes ago at Love Field. Our boys are coming back to the studio here at WFAA-TV with that film, and we'll have it in just a few moments. Let's look at the film again, Ron, and you narrate it this time because you were there. This is the film we showed just a few minutes ago. Go ahead.
Well, this is just prior to the parade. Everyone was sitting around having a good time. I do believe it was a very fervent welcome for President Kennedy. Everybody seemed to be enjoying it.
And the president made a statement earlier how pleased that he was with the turnout and his reception in the Dallas-Fort Worth area.
I think that everybody was just real happy. As the motorcade came down the street, the crowd oftentimes broke loose and dashed out, shook hands with him.
This is Main Street.
Everybody just seemed to be enjoying and having a good summertime outing.
Right. Now, in just a few moments, you'll see almost the exact spot where the president was shot, right in this area on down the road.
Yes, sir. This is a bookstore, a Texas bookstore, right where these officers are, is where the man was supposed to have been on the sixth floor. This is where they found the rifle.
Right.
It was on the sixth floor behind a bunch of boxes mm-hmm. stacked in behind them. The crowd gathered quickly. The officers descended on the area and tried to keep people back, but of course everybody swarmed in, and I guess the roof just sort of fell in on Dallas at this moment.
It has.
We went in with the Secret Service officers. We covered every inch of the building from the roof to the basement, and finally they did discover this gun on the sixth floor. There was no sign of the man. About six or seven witnesses said that they had seen this man, but of course at a time like this everybody sees everybody, it's hard to tell which is true and which is not. The Secret Service agents, the FBI officers, all guarded the doors, would not allow anyone in the building or out. Therefore, I do believe that you'll find that these are exclusive films.
I think
as far as the building itself, this is Sheriff Bill Decker, Dallas County Sheriff. These are officers, and as you notice, they're all armed with riot guns, shotguns, machine guns, everything possible in an attempt to apprehend this man. I do believe that he'll never be taken alive.
You do believe that?
Well, I don't think they'll allow him. I'm afraid this man at this point is so disrupted, he may just do away with himself, if anything else.
That's the conversation we've had here.
Mm-hmm. The crowd swarmed in and did not necessarily hamper operations or anything like that, but
more suspects here, I guess, huh?
They were all taken over to Bill Decker's office where they were interrogated. Anyone who had said that they had seen anything at all, whether it was actually with the shooting or leading up to it, people hanging out of windows, the sheriff took him over and started to interrogate them.
One of our newsmen, Mal Crutch, said that he saw the rifle come out the window. That's it from Dallas, Texas for the moment. We will have more film, and we will have film of Vice President Lyndon Johnson being sworn in later in the day. Now let's go back to New York.
Lyndon Johnson is now President of the United States. He succeeds the President, President Kennedy, who held him in high esteem and had his every confidence. President Johnson took the oath aboard the presidential plane at Dallas's Love Field, and he is now preparing to fly to Washington to take over the reins of the government. Former President Dwight D. Eisenhower today called the assassination of President Kennedy a despicable act. He is stunned. John Ralston is standing by in our Washington studios with Washington Reaction and more of the story of what will happen next. So we take you now to Washington.
The nation's capital has learned of the president's death in stunned disbelief. Outside ABC studios, the sidewalk has been jammed with crowds following developments with shock and bewilderment on loudspeakers and TV screens. One can see the tragic news spreading from mouth to mouth in the streets. Here and there, people are crying, and there are reactions of rage and fury. At the White House, some of the staff was on hand as usual, though some were with the president. One officer was a quick direct channel of the news to Washington officialdom. That was Senator Hubert Humphrey, who rushed to the White House after Congress was informed by way of the staff's direct communication system with Dallas, a system that follows a president wherever he goes. Crowds gathered here, too, and saw the lowering of the White House flag to half-mast when the death of the president was confirmed. This is the Justice Department, crowds outside the offices of Attorney General Kennedy, the president's brother and closest advisor. President Kennedy's other brother, Ted, the senator from Massachusetts, happened to be presiding over the Senate when the first shocking word was whispered to him by a doorkeeper. Senator Kennedy immediately left the building and went to a waiting car. This is John Rolfson, ABC Washington. For other developments, here is Edward P. Morgan.
Even in grief, the government has to get on with its business. For many minutes this afternoon, there was nobody actually at the helm of this great republic. The president lay dead of an assassin's bullet. The vice president, Lyndon B. Johnson, was incommunicado in a hospital suffering from shock. But now, just moments ago, Lyndon B. Johnson has been sworn in as the president of the United States. What is the position that he occupied in terms of his relationship with John F. Kennedy before this act today? It just happens, by the fortunes of coincidence and circumstance, that this reporter was having lunch this afternoon at the Chilean embassy when ABC News called to tell me the news from Dallas. At that lunch was Hubert Humphrey, the whip, the Democratic whip of the U.S. Senate, and Ralph Dungan, one of the chief aides of the president at the White House. I asked Dungan what the relationship actually was between Johnson and Kennedy. Had there been a scintilla of evidence that the president was thinking of, quote, dumping, unquote, Johnson from the ticket in 1964? There had been speculation about this because Johnson's utility in 1960 was to carry as much of the South as possible, and now it seemed that a great deal of the South was going to leave Kennedy on the civil rights issue anyway. Dungan replied firmly that there was not a scintilla of evidence. I asked him how well informed the vice president had been in terms of top-level affairs in the White House and in the administration generally, and his answer was excellent. As a matter of fact, Lyndon B. Johnson, who had a massive heart attack, you may remember, in the summer of 1957 and was not expected to live, has recovered monumentally from that accident, that physical accident, and has been going at top speed ever since. Ironically enough, paradoxically enough, he has not been out of the United States to speak of, except for a brief time in the Navy during World War II, until he became vice president. As vice president, he has traveled as much, if not more, than Richard Nixon traveled for President Eisenhower. He has just come back from the Low Countries, that is to say, Belgium, Luxembourg, and Holland, on an official mission for the president, and earlier he was in Scandinavia. Washington now is stunned and grieving, but the gears are already moving for the presidency of Lyndon B. Johnson. This is Edward P. Morgan in Washington.
We have canceled all of our regularly scheduled programs for the rest of this day, and we will remain on the air until at least 11 p.m. tonight and perhaps later. Mourning, grieving with the country, with our countrymen, and bringing them all of the news that there is to be had in this melancholy day. Jim, President Johnson comes well qualified to this office, doesn't he?
Yes, I think so. I think also that it's fairly important to just summarize the position of the vice president.
Yes.
Over the years. For example, when President Roosevelt died, President Truman, and no disrespect to him, it just happened to be a fact, had to be briefed on the atom bomb after he became president. Now, this couldn't happen these days, and in this world that we're living, with the United States as the leader of the free world, in this nuclear age that we're living, the subsequent vice presidents, Vice President Nixon and Vice President Johnson, have to be informed of these tremendous developments of our country. They are both active members of the National Security Council. And through that vehicle, are completely informed of the policies, the strategies of the United States, and the continuity of office. You have to have a chief executive. And I would assume that probably one of the difficulties and the confusion today that led to the slight delay in the swearing-in of the vice president probably was to get a judge to do it. There must have been considerable, there was considerable confusion, but now we have a new president, and this is Lyndon Johnson. And his he comes in completely, I think, informed about the situation as far as the United States is concerned, both domestically and internationally. And the death of President Kennedy is a tragedy to the United States, and I don't think yet we have really sensed the repercussions of the shock reaction throughout the world as a result of this terrible thing down in Dallas. But President Johnson, through his knowledge of the affairs of the government, comes in prepared and fully acquainted with the problems of the United States, and particularly those as concerns the conduct of foreign affairs of our country in this world today.
Jim, who is now in effect the vice president?
Well, under the Constitution, there isn't a vice president at the present time. The line of succession,
yes,
would be that the Speaker of the House now automatically moves up into second in succession. If my memory is correct, I think that we will not have a vice president now as such until the next general elections in 1964. But to all intents and purposes, under the line of succession, the Speaker of the House is now the second man in the United States as far as the succession of office in the presidency is concerned.
And the third man?
Third man would be the ranking member of the cabinet, which is the Secretary of State, Dean Rusk.
And then so on down
and
the cabinet
down,
line?
Down in the cabinet line, depending upon the formation of that department in the historical formation of that department in time.
Yes.
I think it's the Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, and I did know, but I've forgotten the rest of them.
Now, Jim, what does the... how will the Congress react to this, politically, I mean? Does President Johnson have some advantage with the Congress?
I would think that all Americans are concerned not about politics now. They are concerned about their country and the support of the new president. I think that
pardon me, Jim. Jules Bergman is waiting in Times Square with reaction there. We go to Jules Bergman.
This is Jules Bergman reporting from Times Square, from 44th Street and Broadway in the heart of New York. There is shock and indignation and most of all sadness at the death of President Kennedy here in the heart of Manhattan. A crowd of hundreds has gathered, still unbelieving, still not quite fully able to comprehend exactly what has happened. But there is sadness on their faces and there is disbelief. The flags here in Times Square have been lowered to half-mast. New York's theaters have announced they're closed tonight. There'll be no performances as long as the president lies in state. And even us, we too suffer from the shock. With us in this crowd, a GI back from Germany on leave. What's your name, soldier?
Vincent Bokikio.
How has this shock hit you?
Real bad.
What do you feel about it?
It tightens up inside. He was a good man for the services. I liked him a lot. When he voted, if he ran again, I would vote for him again.
And a lady here waiting this past hour as the crowd is gathered here, listening to headlines, listening to radio news on the story. What is your feeling about it, ma'am?
This shock. I was for Kennedy, and I was going to vote for him. And I was for him. And I just can keep him crying. I really like him.
Do you believe it?
President.
Do you believe it has really happened?
Well, it was told to me so nonchalantly that I almost fell off my chair at work. It just spread through the office very fast. And they let
it down. What about you, sir? What is your reaction?
I was quite shocked. I think the world has lost its greatest leader. And I just can't believe that anybody could be as miserable as that to do what they did to our great president.
Do you feel the people will go on, the nation will not lose its impetus?
No, we'll just carry right on. We're a great nation. And we'll recover. It's a great loss.
What about you, son? You've been here, watched this happen.
Right. Right now, I'm more concerned about the country and the people and what their reaction is going to be. And I think that each of us are going to have to think about more the responsibility that the President Kennedy used to talk about, so that something like this can happen together, and that maybe we can hang together now at a time where we're really going to have to be together now when the country needs this responsibility that the President Kennedy has talked about. I think,
go ahead, right ahead.
I think that it's more important now to think about America and about responsibility, about being in the home and comforting those who are close to you, and ringing on your neighbor's bell and comforting your neighbor, and talking to the person next to you, comforting him and having him comfort you, so that if need be, you'll be able to assume and accomplish what you'll have to.
As if you lost a friend or a relative?
No, it's as if we've lost someone who has assumed the responsibility that we should have assumed all along, and now we're going to have to pick up where he left off, where he had to leave off.
What's your feeling, sir? You've been sitting here.
This is the most dastardly act against mankind that I can remember. The assassination of our great president.
And so, shock, here's another man. What is your feeling, sir?
My feeling is after 42 years recent retirement from the government in Washington, D.C., although a Republican, I think government workers have lost one of the best friends he has ever had for the benefit of better working conditions for all people. And I sincerely hope that whoever did it, you'll bring him to justice so quickly, because he was a great man, a good man, and he believed, after I have spent 42 years, just recently retired, he was a friend of all people, regardless of race, creed, color, religion, or national origin. And I'm deeply from South Carolina. Thank you.
A personal loss is the only way we can describe our feelings, and this crowd of hundreds, this man swarm that is the heart of New York, can describe its feelings. This is Jules Bergman reporting from Times Square.
Lyndon Baines Johnson was sworn in as President of the United States today aboard the presidential airplane and immediately took off from Dallas for Washington. And with him were Mrs. Johnson and the grieving Mrs. Jacqueline Kennedy. They are going to Washington with the president. The grieving family of the Kennedys are assembling at Hyannisport to be with their mother and their father. Senator Edward Kennedy was presiding over the Senate chamber when he was informed that his brother had been shot, and he and his sister Eunice Shriver have flown now to Hyannisport to be with former Ambassador Joseph Kennedy and Mrs. Rose Kennedy. We take you now to the heartland of America and the reaction in Chicago.
The scene here on Chicago's State Street this gloomy, rainy afternoon is much the same as in any American city. Groups of people gathered about wherever a television set is displayed. They now know the news. They know the president is dead. They know that Vice President Johnson has become President Johnson. This was always a Kennedy town. Whenever Mr. Kennedy came to Chicago, as he did a few times since entering the White House, he was greeted by huge throngs. People would wait along the lines from O'Hare Airport to the center of the city for hours, just to catch a passing glimpse of him. There was never any doubt about how the election would go in 1960. Everybody knew that Chicago was a Kennedy town. And the reaction of the people here today, well, they're just numb. Disbelief, all those trite phrases that come to mind, they apply here. Here's a young man in the crowd who's been standing here watching the ABC report of the sad events. Did you ever see the president?
Yes, sir.
When?
In the political campaign of 1960. I was one of the workers for him. Saw him right before a huge torchlight parade that we had about a month before the election. And he shook my hand and asked me about all I could tell him, what was my name. He asked me a few questions. I was just kind of in awe of being near such a great person. And all I remember him saying then was, keep up the good work. And he congratulated not only me, or told not only me to keep up the work, but the whole party system and all the young people in particular.
What are your thoughts now, young man, as you know that your president is dead?
Well, I feel it's a terrible thing, but it's something we're going to have to live with. And I don't think we should fly off the handle and start blaming groups either to the extreme right or the extreme left. It's something that happened. The killer should be brought to justice, but I don't think it was any particular group.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Ma'am, what's your reaction now that you know that President Kennedy is dead?
I think it's a great loss to the country and the whole world. President Kennedy was a good man. I think it's a great loss.
Did you ever see the president when he came here?
No, I've never seen the president. But as a mother and as a wife, I can understand the grief of his family and to the world. It's a terrible loss.
You're thinking now of Mrs. Kennedy?
Yes, I'm thinking of Mrs. Kennedy, his mother and his wife. Yes.
Well, that's about it. Here's a little girl. Do you know that the president is dead?
Yes.
You ever see the president?
No, I haven't.
You've studied about him in school, though,
yes.
Haven't you? What are your thoughts, honey?
Oh, well, I thought that was a terrible disgrace that the president is dead, and I feel very sorry for his wife, and I don't know what else to say.
Well, that's about all there is to say. Crowd gathered here, just standing around, trying to absorb this awful news. This is Frank Reynolds on State Street in Chicago. Now back to New York.
Well, that was Frank Reynolds in Chicago. Incidentally, President Johnson is the 8th Vice President of the United States to assume the presidency through the death of a president. And there's a strange and ironic parallel between his position today and that of Andrew Johnson, who was a man from a southern state who took over when President Lincoln was assassinated. Johnson attempted then to calm down the country from its, to heal the country's racial differences. Dallas is standing by for us. We take you now to Dallas.
This is Dallas, Texas. The gentleman here again is Ron Ryland, one of our cameramen that have some, we have some exclusive film to show you once again. Let's roll the film and we'll narrate it as we go. Ron, these are the police cars pulling into the area.
Right. Once the report went out that this man was holed up in Oak Cliff, we all went out in the motorcade. This is the first building that he was reported in. It's an old junk shop of one kind or another. This is the jacket that the man was wearing. He discarded it as he ran down the street. An eyewitness here said that he had seen the man go into the building, and this is the rear of it. The officers converged on it once again.
Let's make a point here now. This is the film. It is a suspect.
This is a suspect, right. Yes. They saw this man running in and out that answered the description
Not
of the original man. No, this is an eyewitness, Jay. The man that is being interrogated here said he saw the man run down the street. Of course, everywhere we went, the crowds converged and hampered operations quite a bit. This is the scene where the police officer was shot. The car that you see in the background there belonged to the police officer, and this woman said that she had seen a man answering the description of the man that was later captured run up, stop the officer, and then shoot him. About that time, another report came in that there was a man had walked into the Texas Theater further down the block with a shotgun over his arm. Of course, everybody broke and ran down into the area at the time. This gun that you see in the background here in this officer's hand is the one that allegedly was used to shoot the police officer. This is the officer's billfold that was found lying on the ground right alongside of the car. The crime investigators here are fingerprinting the car in hopes that they could possibly lift a print to use. Now we're inside of the Texas Theater. Of course, everything is black. The movie is going on. Police suddenly jumped this man and started to drag him out of the theater, hustled him out to the car as the crowd broke and started to maul the police officers and grab this man, trying to run with him. They shouted murder and just almost anything to try and get at this man. As you see here, the officers hustled him into the car and ran away just as fast as they could from this Texas Theater in hopes of protecting this man, and they have taken him off to an unknown spot. We don't know where they're holding him for the interrogation. Once again, these are exclusive films. We were the only photographers at the scene, Mr. Watson.
The name of the officer slain was J.D. Tipton. This information, Police Captain Pat Ganaway today said a suspect held in the assassination, the picture you just saw here, was an employee of the building where a rifle was found. Ganaway also said the suspect had visited Russia and was married to a Russian. This is not immediately confirmed. The suspect's citizenship is not known. Ganaway said the suspect was the same man who shot and killed a city policeman in the Oak Cliff section of the city. And if so, those are the pictures we just saw, correct?
We sure hope so.
All right. The city of Dallas is in shock. We will have pictures and comments from our citizens in just a few moments.
If I may interject a point here, we do have pictures upcoming of the gun that actually shot the president and things like that. They'll be along shortly.
Okay, we'll have that in just a few moments here on ABC from WFAA-TV in Dallas. I haven't been outside of the building since about 10 minutes after this tragic event happened in the city of Dallas. I have talked to the newsmen, and they say the entire city is in, the entire nation is stunned and shocked.
People are walking around the street in whispers and things like that. They don't talk loud. There's no screaming or hollering as you normally find in a city. Everybody is just absolutely stunned, as you pointed out.
Well, it happened in our city.
Yes.
And this is a shock that I imagine will live forever in our hearts. I can only compare this to the time when Franklin D. Roosevelt passed away and the shock that came over everyone. This is the way the city of Dallas is today. People are walking the streets. No one is doing any work. Everyone is sitting and talking and wondering how in the world it could happen in the city of Dallas. How could it happen here? And probably a better question than that is, why did it happen in the city of Dallas? We will stay with the coverage, and I understand that ABC has canceled all their programming. Of course, we have canceled our local programming. We will stay with this story throughout the day. We are in the process now of developing a complete resume and wrap-up from the time President Kennedy landed at Carswell Air Force Base last night until the present. We will have a complete resume and pictures of everything that has happened. That's it from here. Thank you, Ron. Now back to ABC in New York.
With me is Bob Young of ABC's news staff. Bob, would you bring us up to date on the...
Don, I've just returned from Wall Street, where, as you may have heard, the trading there stopped at 2:07 this afternoon. It's not clear whether the market will open tomorrow on time or not, and the tape was running 34 minutes late when I was down there. There was much grief in Wall Street today. I talked to a man, an older man, a man from another country, who literally broke down in tears before my eyes when this news came to him. Members of the Kennedy family, as you probably know, are gathering at the home of the president's family in Hyannisport, Massachusetts. The president's children, John and Caroline, are at the White House. It's not known whether they have been told of the loss of their father as yet. The nation remains stunned. Many Americans have wept. Many are angry, too. Former President Eisenhower said that he was shocked, dismayed, grieved. Mayor Wagner in New York held a press conference not long ago in which he said that President Kennedy has joined the line of martyrs. Mayor Wagner is a Catholic, as President Kennedy was himself. A late word here has it that Andrews Air Force Base officials said today that the president's body would be returned to Washington from Dallas at 6:05 Eastern time tonight. Don?
There was a terrible, cruel irony in today's tragic happenings, beside the tragedy itself. President Kennedy had been particularly happy on this trip because beside him was his beloved wife, Jacqueline. Mrs. Kennedy had been prevented, you remember, from being with the president on any major speaking tour since the primary campaign that preceded his nomination in 1960 as the Democratic candidate for president. During the actual presidential election, Mrs. Kennedy was expecting her second child, John Jr., and in more recent months she had curtailed her public activities following the death of their newly born son, Patrick Bouvier Kennedy. And again, with cruel irony, the president and his wife had received a heartwarming welcome from those Texas crowds. Lyndon Baines Johnson, who fought off a near fatal heart attack at 47 and went to work, he went on to work, he got back in it with both feet, and he faces his greatest challenge today, of course. He goes to the White House, however, with more experience than any modern predecessor, but with a very special kind of a heartache, because Kennedy's life was taken in Johnson's state. Johnson, at the age of 55, with more than a quarter of a century of Washington service behind him, brings to the presidency greater experience than that accumulated by Vice President Richard Nixon or by Harry S. Truman before he entered the White House in 1945. President Johnson has served as a House member, as a senator, and as the greatest majority leader in current political history. Not always loved for his opponents on Capitol Hill, of course, but always respected. He's credited by the Democrats with swinging the South to Kennedy's column in the critical 1960 election. Johnson brought to the vice presidency all the vigor that he had thrown into his own presidential nomination campaign. He led the administration's drive for improvement on racial relations. And, of course, he incurred the hostility on the part of his own native territory a great deal. He headed the president's space council, and he hammered steadily at the need for continuing the lunar program despite economy opposition. And President Kennedy himself said just the other day, as he entered Texas, that we were going ahead with the lunar program and that we would follow our hat over the wall of space. He was committed to it. He said the country should be committed to it, and this time we would be first. As the president's special emissary, President Johnson went around the world on goodwill tours. He's been away quite a bit recently. He visited the Far East, including battle-torn South Vietnam in 1961. He later carried the country's message to the Middle East, to Scandinavia, and to the common market countries. Any country that was in the news, in the world news, President Johnson has been there, and recently. And he had returned only recently from that latter trip to the common market countries. He was tired, he said, but he was ready for the next assignment. President Johnson spoke in West Virginia the day after he and his wife, Lady Bird, arrived in Washington from Europe, and he's been busy ever since. And President Kennedy is reported to have said that he wanted Lyndon Johnson on his ticket when he ran again for re-election next year. President Johnson is one of the most powerful political figures in Washington, of course. Just how his political leverage has survived remains to be seen. But again, he is a man who commands respect throughout the country and in the Congress. Of course, many folks thought that Johnson would have to slow down considerably when he became vice president. That's normally just a ceremonial job, although it's been more active in recent years. But he took so many duties on his shoulders that he needed three offices for his operations down there in Washington. And Edward P. Morgan is ready in Washington. We switch you now to ABC Studios in Washington.
President Kennedy ran more risks than most chief executives of the United States. His epitaph, as a matter of fact, ironically enough, might be called the title that he used for a book of his own, Profile in Courage. I was at the Berlin Wall with him early this summer when the dangers to him seemed to be very high. He took everything completely in stride. This afternoon, after we heard the news, I asked one of his close associates in the White House if the president had ever discussed the possibility of danger to him. He said as far as he knew, he never had, and as far as he knew, and it was his own experience, that he did not have a fearful bone in his body. The orientation in Washington inexorably now has to be toward the Johnson administration. At this moment, only a matter of quarter hours, not much more, after the death of John F. Kennedy, one has to make the hunching guess that the rather moribund atmosphere and tempo of Congress will be quickened now in terms of dealing with the Kennedy New Frontier program of legislation. Lyndon Johnson was extremely aware of the must list topped by the tax cut and civil rights. And with his own peculiar facility with dealing with Congress, he was majority leader of the Senate, you remember, during the Eisenhower years, he may well have a more forceful impetus and impact on the Congress than President Kennedy himself did. As a matter of fact, in terms of what criticism of the president there was, it usually fell on the point that he was not as strong in his insistence with Congress as he might have been given his own popularity and the prestige of his office. Johnson is, in some respects perhaps, more intimately aware of the high issues, secrets, and other aspects of government than Richard Nixon was under President Eisenhower. He has done the same sort of assignment as Nixon did for Eisenhower, that is to say, he has been a goodwill emissary abroad, but he has also been, and this has been very important, an emissary in terms of the president.